Hello, welcome to my talk, All About the Fruits. This talk is on an important topic on how we can calculate a tensor divergence, since this calculation would be used in the derivation of Navier-Stokes equation, as well as in formulating the transport equations for turbulence models. In this talk, I will show how the problem is caused, and how we can get the correct formula for calculating the tensor divergence. In deriving Euler and Navier-Stokes equation in the moment equation, we need to include both the body force and the surface force acting on the fluid, especially if the fluid with cross force or stress is involved. Based on the Newton's second law of motion, the moment equation of the fluid dynamics would be expressed as this. Here, scalar V is the fluid volume with the enclosing surface S, and the vector V is the flow velocity. Vector F is the body force per fluid volume, and the vector n is the normal vector on the surface S. Tensor capital T double arrow is the fluid total tensor, including pressure, viscous stresses. Using the Gauss divergence theorem, we can change the integral on the surface into the integral on the fluid volume V here. So we can write the moment equation in this form. And we can employ the Reynolds transport theorem for the left-hand side term. Here, F is an arbitrary function, can be either scalar or vector. Here, we can take F equals rho times vector V, and then we can obtain the differential equation for the momentum as this. For incompressible flows, we can have the equation as this. Here we can see double vector V and capital T double arrows are both tensors, and the oblation this and this are the tensor divergences. Based on the Stokes assumption for the Newtonian fluid, we could have the total tensor T double arrow expressed as in this form. Here, the first term on the right-hand side is from the pressure, and the negative sign here means the pressure is always opposite with the surface normal vector. And this term is the tensor for the fluid compressibility effect. And the lambda is called the second viscosity coefficient. The last term is the fluid viscous stress tensor. So on the specific surfaces, for instance, on the small cube, on the surface S1, S2, and S3, we have the tensor component expressed in this form. Here, based on the book Marine Hydrodynamics, tau 21 denotes the stress acting in the y direction. This is indicated by the first index 2. On a surface of constant x, which is indicated by the second index 1. Accordingly, tau 12 denotes the stress acting in the x direction on a surface of constant y. Similarly, we have tau 11 denotes a stress acting in the x direction on a surface constant x. For a closed surface S with a volume of V, the surface force acting on the fluid due to the viscous stress tensor tau double arrow would be calculated as this. So if we apply the Gauss divergence theorem, we can change the integral on a surface S into the volume integral on V. We have this expression. Here, the stress tensor divergence can be regarded as the force of unit volume. Now, the question is how we can calculate the divergence of a tensor in Einstein summation convention. Based on the relevant references, we have two different expressions for the divergence of a tensor in Einstein notation. Based on the famous book Marine Hydrodynamics, we have the expression for the divergence of a tensor given by this. And we can also find from the book Turbulence Modeling for CFD, the divergence of a tensor is given by this. So we can see here the difference is the derivation with the xj or with xi. Why we have such two different expressions? Basically, they came from different expression for a vector. For example, we can express the vector with a colon given as this for the normal vector. The components n1, n2, and n3 are put into a colon. So the Gauss divergence theorem is given as this, and here the final result would be the vector force given in a form of a colon. Otherwise, we may express the vector in a row given as this. And if we use the same Gauss divergence theorem, we have this, and the vector force would be given in a form of a row. So if we look at this expression, the summation is on j, and the vector indicates with I, and here the summation is on I, and the vector is indicated with the index j. If we write the divergence of the tensor in details for different expression, we have the first expression as this. So the first row, we can take I equals 1 and the summation for j from 1 to 3. And the second row, taken I equals 2, summation on j. And the third row, I equals 2, 3, and the summation on j. So for the second expression, we have the vector expressed in a row. So the first colon would be given by j equals 1, and the summation on I from 1 to 3. The second colon would be on j equals 2, and the summation on I. And the third column, j equals 2, 3, and the summation on I. So if we compare the component fx, for the first expression, we have the expression like this. And the second expression, the fourth component given by this. Obviously, we can see the difference is this. In here, we have tau 1, 1, tau 1, 2, and the tau 1, 3. But here we have tau 1, 1, tau 2 1 and tau 3 1. Now we look at the expression for the fluid viscous stress. For a Newtonian fluid, the conventional fluid viscous stress is assumed as the metric stress tensor given by this tau ij. This is the Cauchy's symmetric viscous stress tensor. So if we substitute this expression into the expression in this, so we have this and we have this. So we can write this by exchanging the order of the derivation with regard to xi and with regard to xj, we have this. And for the second expression, we have this, and we can obtain the expression as this. And further, we can write the expression as this. For this term, we exchange the order of the derivation with regard to xi and with regard to xj. So we can see this term actually are same because both are vector with the remaining index here is I and here is j. But the summation here and the summation here, physically these two terms are same. And these terms are same as well. So we can conclude these two expressions for the divergence of tensor would be same if the stress tensor is symmetric. So here, if we apply the continuity equation for the incompressible flow, and we can see this term would be zero. Therefore, we have the expression this and the final expression at this. Same for the second expression, this term would be zero, and the expression would be this. And write it into the vector form, we have this. So we can see both expressions are same for the incompressible flow. However, if the fluid viscous stress tensor is not symmetric, as recently shown by the author, see the reference below, the fluid viscous stress tensor component should be given as this. Here, I would like to say this expression is from the direct physical definition of the fluid viscous stress. So, for the first expression of the tensor divergence, we have this, and we have this. So this is equivalent to this. For the second expression of the tensor divergence, so we have this, and we have this. And if we consider the continuity equation for the incompressible flow, so this term would be zero. And obviously, these two expressions are not the same. Now we have the question, which one is the correct formula for the Einstein notation of the tensor divergence? Or whether both of them are incorrect? From the result of the asymmetric tensor, the second expression would lead to a zero viscous force in the incompressible flows. Hence, it reasonably deduced the second formula is incorrect. But is there any proof for this conclusion? So we go back to the fluid element here in the figure. So on the surfaces of the cube, we can have the force due to the stress component tau to 2. So we can see on both sides the black arrows. The net force in y direction would be given as this. Here, theta v is given by this. And if we consider the tensor component tau to 3, you can see on the bottom and on the upper surface, we can calculate the net force due to the tensor component tau to 3 given by this. And similarly, if we consider the tensor component tau to 1, this would be given as this. The net force in y direction would be given in this. So if we put all this together, and the net force because of the viscous stress tensor in y direction would be given by this. So based on the calculation in the previous slide, the total force in y direction due to the fluid viscous stresses would be given as this. Therefore, the total force acting in y direction per volume would be given by this. So the expression in the ellipse is the correct expression for the net force in y direction due to the stress tensor, because this formula is from the direct physical analysis. If we compare these two tensor divergence expressions, this and this, and for the component in y direction, we have this and this. So if we compare this to this result from the direct physics, you can see the first expression is correct, and the second expression is not correct. However, in this slide, it should be noted that this talk proves the correct form of the tensor divergence, but this development should not be taken for excluding the use of the vector in rows. If only a slightly different form of the surface force expression is employed, given by this. Here, tau prime double arrow is the transpose of the viscous stress tensor, tau double arrow, and the vector here is given in a form as this. And the corresponding Gauss divergence theorem should be given in this. And as such, we can still deduce the correct form of the tensor divergence in Einstein notation as this.